Okay, we're live. Welcome to the Sunday Lovecraft eZine Talk Show, and today is March the 22nd, 2015, and Laird Barron is our guest today. Thanks for being on the show, Laird.
Thanks for having me.
Of course, we got Joe Pulver here and Matt Carpenter and Rick Lay. Thanks, guys. Don't let me hog the conversation, guys. You got questions for Laird, please jump in, and I will keep an eye on the message board for anybody watching live. Throw some questions out there, and I'll try to get to those as well. So Laird, let's start off with, what are you working on for the rest of this year? You told me you got a couple of books coming up.
I actually have a couple of manuscripts on submission with my agent. As far as what I'm working on, I have about 10 or 12 short pieces, anything from 4,000 or 5,000 words to novella lengths that are due to be turned in by fall, winter. And I'm also working on another horror novel.
Can you talk
Are you working with a specific publisher?
What, Matt?
Are you working with a specific publisher?
On some of the short fiction, I am. Actually, almost all of it's been commissioned. Matter of fact, let me think about this for a second. Yeah, every single piece has been commissioned, but we'll see if they all get accepted. The novel, I'll just turn that over to my agent, and then we'll find out.
Short fiction is for, like, individual anthologies and not another collection?
Right. I have a collection on submission. I just turned it over to my agent, you know, recently. But I'm going to have another at least 100,000 words of short fiction that I'll complete this year. But it'll all be individual pieces, you know, some to magazines, some to anthologies, some to online venues.
Right.
So I have a lot of stuff happening right now.
We heard through another source that one of your short stories, 30, was optioned for a movie.
Oh, yeah.
Did you want to tell us about that?
Sure. 30 was in occultation, and for anybody out there that might be interested but hasn't read it, it's about a couple wildlife biologists who are studying aberrant wildlife behavior in Eastern Washington, and they're in a little modular, a little habitat, and they're fairly isolated for about a 3-month stretch, and things begin to deteriorate. And Philip Gillette, he was the writer for a very fine independent film called The Europa Report. It came out a year or two ago, a couple years ago now, I guess. I really liked it. And so he contacted my agents and made a pitch for the film, and he ended up with the rights to it. I've talked with him. I'm really excited about it, because you never know what's going to happen. You know, there's so many steps to getting a movie made. So, and then what's it going to look like? And he really wants to. What he's shown me, sort of talked to me about so far, looks really, really close to the actual story. He seems committed to being as true to the story as he can, while still altering it for film so that it works on screen. And I should be seeing a script soon, and he's going to start shooting this summer, is the plan.
So you're not the script writer?
No.
Screenwriter?
No.
They did a really great job on Europa.
Do you have any, like, input then? Like, besides, like, do they let you look at it and make comments? I don't know how it works.
Right. Well, basically, he's working on some kind of a script right now. And from what I understand, you know, this is probably the second or third version of the script. He's very meticulous. And judging from the writing on Europa Report, you know, I'm not surprised. But I imagine I'll get a chance to look at it. He was very, you know, when we were talking about it, we talked for a couple hours about the film not too long ago and the story. And, he was open to all kinds of input. That's why I'm cautiously optimistic. And I say cautiously only because we have to wait and see if everything, you know, it's a film, and so there's a lot of moving pieces, producers, and, you know, the money has to come in, and it all has to shooting schedules and whatnot, but from what we talked about, it was terrific, and he was open to my input, which really relieved me, because I have some strong feelings about the characters in the story. You know, on one hand, I'm very practical and pragmatic. I understand once you sign off on a film deal, it turns out as it turns out. You don't really get a final say on it. But in this case, you know, I was able to express some of my concerns about what I would like to see, and he was on the same page. So my fingers are crossed. This is going to be, not only is it going to get done, but it's going to be a good film.
That's got to be encouraging that they're listening to your input on it, not just saying, take the story and do what we want with it. You know?
Well, you know, I have a little experience with this. I've never had anything actually get made, but I've had quite a few options, and I have seen anything from a 10-page treatment to a 35-page treatment. I have seen several screenplays for various works, and usually it's pretty discouraging from the artistic perspective. So, you know, I haven't seen the screenplay on this one yet, but the ideas that he has are much closer to, you know, because I've dabbled in writing. I'm working on a couple screenplays myself, and I already know that how difficult it is to adapt even your own work to the screen. So this seems to be a little different deal than what I've run into in the past. In the past, they've really taken a lot of the Barron out of the story, and this one he seems committed to leaving as much of the spirit of the story intact as possible. So we'll see.
That's great.
Well, I had a question about the story, because this was after I heard this, I went back and I reread it, and I had this question about the setting. It's like it was almost striking to me that, like, you said aberrant behavior, but it's almost like, was this post-apocalyptic? Was this a ground zero for something bad that was happening, or was this just, like in a lot of your stories, there's a bad place or a place where the true darkness gets through? Do you know what I mean? I just had it was just sort of like, I had a hard time, like, this has to be like, just one thing you do is you put things in this larger context and you don't explain the world. You know, it's like, it's not like this is this self-contained. It's like we're seeing just a little piece of everything.
No, that's a good observation. And it's in modern times. It's not a dystopia or a apocalyptic setting or anything like that. You know, the thing is the inspiration for it comes from several places, but a lot of the stuff in the story comes from things that I've cobbled together from actual occurrences. The inspiration for it derives from a CSI team a few years ago went to the Manson Ranch in California, and they were looking for mass graves. The federal government had determined at the time that there may have been a lot of murders committed by Manson and his followers out there, you know, in their little nomadic camps that they had. So they sent a CSI team a few years ago. And from what I understand, they didn't discover much, but it was just the spirit of the endeavor. They took cadaver dogs. They took a large team of scientists with all kinds of equipment. They took equipment that can radiate, you know, x-ray the ground, essentially. They took these devices that you drive into the ground, and they call them sniffers. They sniff for material that is possibly would be decomposed organic matter that might, you know, be you know, animal or human matter. And so, I read about this, and it just struck me, you know, what did they talk about? Because they were out there for a couple weeks, and what did they talk about out in the prairie at night? Because they were camped out. So here you are camped out on possibly mass grave sites by one of the most notorious groups of nefarious people, you know, in our history. And it just struck me as that's a good setting for a creepy story. But I wanted to take it a step further. I wanted to isolate a couple, because the whole occultation collection is about one of the things I return to touchstones is relationships, good and bad. And so if you'll notice, a lot of those stories, it's about two people interacting, and they have some kind of romantic relationship in most cases. And so I isolate these two, and I decided that I wanted to go with aberrant behavior of animals because I had actually experienced this years ago up in Alaska when I lived out in the wilderness. We were pretty nomadic ourselves, and one of the places we lived was near Glen Allen in the Copper Valley. And it's one of those places way up in the mountains, 7 to 10 miles off a highway. The sun goes down in the wintertime at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It doesn't come up again until 10 in the morning. No radio, no electricity, no nothing. We're just living in tents. And one of the things that was really spooky about it is that there were no insects. Alaska is known for its mosquitoes. That's our state. That used to be our state bird. There are no mosquitoes out there. And there were. We would find whole, and it's something I touch on a lot of my stories, is the skeletons. You find intact skeletons of, like, say, squirrels or, other small animals, birds. We would find intact skeletons of these animals hanging from branches and whatnot, which is really, I'm going to tell you, if you've never lived out in the woods, that's highly unusual. Bones are not unusual. Carcasses are not unusual, but intact skeletons, so nothing touched it. A bird died, or a squirrel would die, and nothing would feed on it. It would just decompose, and you'd have this intact structure there. And so, I incorporated that. The other thing I incorporated is I was about 13 years old at the time, and we had sled dogs. We had basically it was an encampment, so we could train our teams and our sled dog teams. And we had a handler, this guy from California, a young guy, 22, 23 years old. Anyway, he kind of had a little bit of a falling out with my dad, and so he was staying at a separate camp and just sort of living off the land, doing his own thing. And about 3 weeks later, he shows up at our, on our doorstep, and he's all panicky, and he had a 7mm rifle with a long-distance scope on, like a Leopold scope, so it was like a sniper rifle, essentially. And he starts interrogating, my dad wasn't there, he starts interrogating my brothers and I, and asking us if we've been around, hanging around his camp, and, playing pranks on him and stuff. And he's just shaking. You could tell he has adrenaline coursing through him. And what it ended up being is that he had been hearing noises outside his camp at night, and he had heard chanting. Allegedly he's hearing chanting. And of course, I can't stress enough how remote this place is. And so there are canyons going every which way. And he said, it's just like something out of a horror movie from the 70s, like a bunch of Satanists are getting together and they're all doing the Gregorian chant kind of thing. And he says, it's just terrifying. And he admitted he had concealed himself in a copse of trees above our camp and had blasted us with his sniper rifle for several hours to watch, see what we were doing. And then he had sort of satisfied himself that we weren't involved, and so he came down and was, interrogating us. So anyhow, my dad, of course, when he returned, he packed him into a truck and took him out and said, up to the highway and said bye, and kicked him out. And we didn't think much more of it. It was just sort of like, family, sort of like this family legend, how many of the time that guy, did that. About a year and a half later, he had left the place. We had moved back down into central Alaska, and my father ran into an old acquaintance. He said, "Hey, how you doing, Marcia?" And she says, "Oh, it's terrible. My old owl passed away, and I think it's just from a broken heart." And his grandson's girlfriend had run away to join a cult, as it turned out, who lived about 10 miles from where we were. So there was a mining colony a couple valleys over, and they raised goats, strangely enough, hundreds of goats. And it turns out that, at least according to this old lady and a few other people that we talked to, that they were a cult of some kind, and they were kind of like the Moonies. They were gathering up young people and putting them to work up there in the mountains at their mine, their gold mine. And there were 40, 50 people up there and hundreds of goats. So I do think back to that guy. I wonder, maybe he wasn't quite as nutty as we thought at the time.
That's a hell of a story.
So that found, you know, little pieces of that found. There's a scene in the story where he talks about spying on his girlfriend through the scope of his rifle, and I got that from, you know, from that real experience. So I take stuff like that and meld it in, which I think, you know, is par for the course for an author.
Yeah, you know, in The Beautiful Thing That Awaits Us All, in the introduction, Mr. Partridge is quoting from an interview, and I just want to read a little bit of this and get your comments on it. You're talking about in the winter of 1993, you were racing a team of Huskies and going to say it was near sunset, 30 or 40 degrees below Fahrenheit, lonely wilderness in all directions. Periodically, here's where I'm quoting, periodically I noted old pylons made of sawn logs erected off the beaten path, markers. Initially, I didn't have much reaction, but as darkness drew down around us, the dog's ears pricked up and a general sensation of nervousness radiated from the team. Within a few minutes, I was very much overcome by a sense of dread, a profound and palpable impression of being watched by an immeasurable presence. It sounds a little bit like what you were just talking about, but can you comment a little bit more on that? That sounds fascinating. You know, that kind of atmosphere.
Well, sure, I'm sure. That was in the Iditarod, that would be, I believe, 93. And Alaska, I've noticed that about Alaska. It sort of has the, especially when you get out in the woods a little bit, it sort of has this edge to it. And over the years, you know, we've had the dubious honor of leading the nation in per capita homicides, rapes, assaults, all kinds of crazy stuff. You can put some of it down, I believe, to seasonal affective disorder, you know, cabin fever, things like that. But I think there's something else to it. There's just something about the immensity and the ancient or refined, as Joe would say, nature of the landscape, this primeval nature that I think it gets into. You know, I don't want to make too much of it. But I put almost 40,000 miles in the back of a team in my youth, and that's a lot of hours standing on a pair of runners going across the state. And, you know, very few times in my career, you know, I did that from the time I was about 13 till I was 25, so about 12, 13 years there. And very, very few, probably on one hand, can I count the times that I ever felt I was afraid inexplicably. Maybe 3-4 times in my entire career. I was afraid many times because of open water, or there was natural hazards that I could, and other people. People are a big hazard up in Alaska, actually. But this was one of those rare, strikingly rare occasions where I felt, and I didn't, you know, here's the thing, I didn't attribute it to any kind of, and I don't attribute it to some sort of supernatural phenomenon. However, I don't rule anything out either. It's inexplicable. It was there was nobody around. I mean, granted, there were other racers, but there was, you know, I couldn't see anybody, and that isn't how it felt. And what was interesting is I got into the checkpoint, and it was, you know, dawn probably by the time I came grinding into the checkpoint. So I was out there all night, and then, you know, the natives there I talked to, they were like, oh yeah, that's not, you're not wanted. Some of those, I don't know where all the paths went. Some of them were like hunting trails and whatnot, but some of them went to burial grounds or other sort of sacred places. And they were all marked. You know you're in really dangerous territory when you see these pylons. These pylons are anywhere from 3 feet to like 5 feet tall. And there's not a lot of timber out there, so they're scrounging the stuff up. But they put like bicycle reflectors all over it, so that when it's dark, if you turn on your headlamp or if you're on a snowmobile, it'll come back at you. But see, the reason they do that is because if the wind blows so hard out there sometimes that you can't see 10 feet, and so the only thing will keep you going whatever direction you're, and they have different colors and all that, but the only way that you can figure out where you're going is you might have a little speck of reflected light coming through the blizzard. But yeah, they told me, they said, yeah, don't go down, you know, any of those trails. It's not, you know, you're not wanted. And what was interesting, this gentleman named Jerry Austin, he was, he worked for, I believe, Chevron for, you know, years and years ago. But he was a big game hunter type, real manly man, real nice guy, gregarious, but just tough as nails. And I remember when I mentioned it in front of him, and I actually anticipated that he was going to mock me about it, and he's just dead serious. He goes, you know what? Me, Dewey Halverson, Joe Reddington, there's a few of us, these old-timers, because none of us like that area, because that's one of the... Because these guys have been doing it for years before I came along. I had talked to at least a dozen people who say, no, that's one section of the trail out of a 1,200-mile trail that... And you only do it every other year. The middle of the Iditarod, there's a halfway point, but it's a different halfway point even in odd years. So these guys only travel, you know, we only travel every other year. So they were like, you know, this is a bad stretch. They always hustle through there. So they weren't, they just kind of pat me in the back and gave me a shot of bourbon. They're like, good, you're part of the club, you know? So, but Alaska has a lot of places like that you know, people will talk about, wow, I just get the creeps out there. There's nobody, you know, and who knows, you know, maybe it's a bear, maybe it's a person, maybe it's just something in the landscape itself. I don't know.
Yeah. Could you maybe use this?
I heard this is unrelated to your fiction, but I heard that they're having to change the course of the Iditarod because of a lack of snow. Is that true?
Yeah. Actually, the race is over now. They've had to do it in the past. They usually start in Anchorage, the ceremonial start, and then the next day is what they call the restart, and it's about 40, 50 miles, well, actually about 60 miles away. But this year they had to do the restart in Fairbanks, and it shortened the trail by about 200 miles because there was just no snow going over the Alaska Range, from what I understand, so it would just been, you know, people could get really seriously injured, so they opted for discretion.
Rick, you had a question?
Yeah, just that section of land in Alaska, did you ever use that in the story specifically?
Not yet. Although I'm writing a bunch of Alaska-based stories now, specifically and set in Alaska, so I might.
Is it too early to talk about, you mentioned at the start of our little chat here, that you're working on a novel. Is it too early to talk about that?
Or? No. No, I mean, it's going to be a while before I'm done, but sure. It's set in, it's actually, maybe I should preface this, a lot of the stories that I'm working on are set in a sort of a contiguous universe. I mean, most of my stuff is sort of intertwines with everything else, but not necessarily overtly.
Right.
But and there's some tricky stuff there because I have at least two universes going. Somebody asked me about that. They're like, well, how can all this, you know, work? And I said, well, actually, there's a parallel universe. If you read an Imago sequence, if you read a story called Parallax, I don't want to ruin the story, but there's a point in the story where if you pay attention to that, you'll go, there's two universes. And then I touch on it again in Carrion Gods, the Carrion Gods in their heaven, and the Beautiful Thing. A character from that story is in the story. So it's very subtle. You don't need to read one to enjoy the other, but if you happen to read all of them and you put it together, there's something there for you to discover. So the novel, though, is set in... It's actually taking place here in New York in the Hudson Valley. It's set in 1970, and it's going to be I think the mood of it, I think you could classify it as sort of a Hitchcock, Stephen King, kind of a mood. You know, it's a bit of a thriller, there's a little bit of horror, supernatural horror component to it. But it's about a Boy Scout, 12 years old, and he is the son of a deputy sheriff, and he's a real Don Knotts kind of guy, a Barney Fife kind of guy, I should say. And the boy falls out of a tree. His dad's helping him with the treehouse, and isn't much of a carpenter, and so there's a little accident, and the kid falls, and he breaks his back. And so the kid's really depressed, and he's an outdoorsman, and so his dad's trying to come up with anything to comfort him, and so he gets him involved with penpaling. I've done a little research on penpaling, and it was a pretty big thing in the 60s and 70s. And the kid finds out that he's got a gift for gab, and he really is charming. And so he, within a short period of time, has a lot of pen pals. Unfortunately, one of them turns out to be a serial killer. And yeah, it goes from there. Basically, the supernatural component, this shouldn't hurt anything, just to give you an example, when he realizes that not only is he dealing with a deranged individual who knows where he lives, but he gets a, he gets these letters from the guy and he starts comparing them, and he realizes that some of them are postmarked the same day, except from different places in the world, like one from Japan, one from Norway, exact same day postmark, and so now he's really not understanding what's happening.
Yeah.
So I'm in the research. I've written the first couple chapters, but I'm researching IBM. IBM was very big in Kingston here in the 60s and 70s, and I happen to know a gentleman who's working for IBM, so we're chatting, and I'm doing a bunch of research on the Boy Scouts. I'll give you guys, talk about synchronicity, because I have about 12 or 14 novel ideas that I could go with at any given time. And I was talking to my good friend John Langan, and I ran a room from John and his family, and John is like, well, which one are you going to work on? Are you going to work on the Jessica Mace novel, or are you going to work on the... I've got a novel in the works about a war dog, a cyborg war machine, and I've got this Boy Scout story. I said, well, I'm really leaning toward the Boy Scout story, but, these other two ideas are really calling me as well. I said, but, the thing about the Boy Scout story is I got to do all this research. We had a ton of research on the Boy Scouts in the 70s, 60s and 70s, so, really... That's going to be labor intensive, and I don't have, I can go get it. My girlfriend's a librarian, so I've gotten in there, but it's work. It's work beyond just the writing. And the next day, John comes back to the house, and he goes, I think you're going to be writing your Boy Scout novel. We have this little country post office that we get our mail at, and there's a little book, like a little free book bin out in front. Not 10 minutes where he got, because they hadn't been there earlier in the day, and he went back looking for a package. Not 10 minutes before that, somebody dropped off a pile of Boy Scout manuals, Den Scout Master, how do you run meetings, they were all set like in the 70s and 80s, but they were all like from the 50s and 60s. So it's old books that I'm looking for, and there was a pile of them. So he brings us, here you go, the universe is... And they'd been damaged by flood, water or something. They were they're kind of moldering, so I had to dry them out. But I said, okay, yeah. I think the universe has moved that I write that one, so that's what I'm going to do.
In that direction.
Yeah, I got nudged.
I actually think the issue of the pen palling is interesting, because I got caught up in that when I was a kid. Charlie Brown regularly wrote to his pen pal, and we all did that at our church. We were given addresses of someone overseas, and we wrote them letters, dear pen pal, and if you got a response back, you're supposed to write a letter back. So I think I did that back and forth once or twice. Mm-hmm. It was like, you're right, that was a real big thing.
Right, exactly.
I think a lot of the kids who grew up back then did that.
I kind of want to do a Norman Rockwell goes to hell kind of story. I want this to be innocent, and I like the... How should I say this? Unlike a lot of my colleagues, I don't have a problem with the modern technology aspect of horrifying people. I don't care about cell phones and computers and instant communication. That doesn't faze me one bit. I write around it. But I do enjoy, because I'm trying to do backstory on a lot of the stuff that I'm working on now, a lot of the short fiction. And so I really want to build not just the stories themselves, but the history behind a lot of these recurring characters. I actually have three series characters now that I'm laboring, feverishly trying to get them caught up. And so it helps me to know where they come from or what their parents were like, etc. And so, like, this story here, this novel will tie into everything it'll tie into a lot of the stuff in The Beautiful Thing and Occultation 30, actually, specifically. A lot of the stuff, like I said, a lot of stuff in The Beautiful Thing, but it's just that it's I like the time period. I like 1970. That was the year it was born, and it's not so much that it makes it easier for me. In a lot of ways, it'll make it more difficult because I have to do a ton of research. But I like the innocence. I like the innocence and the sort of isolation comparatively that kids would have. Kids were not, These days, parents really hover over their kids. Back then, you know, as soon as the sodium lamps start clicking on, you come home. You know, as soon as it gets dark, come home type of thing. So kids were up to a lot of, you know, they had secret lives that back then, and a lot of ways more innocent. And I like the innocence. I think Stephen King, you know, he's really used that to his advantage over the years because he juxtaposes innocence of the time period. Like say, you know, when they do the backstory where the kids are all growing up, you know, back in the day, he juxtaposes that with that innocence and that naivete with raw primordial evil. And I kind of want to do that because not only is this kid young and naive, but he also, his family's religious, and he is a Boy Scout. I mean, we're talking, that's like, you know, that is almost like a modern-day knight in a really innocent kind of way. And so I want to use that. And I think there's a lot of material to mine there.
It's really funny that you say that about the 70s. I've mentioned to these guys on the show before that there's something really fascinating to me about the 70s, and I can't really even articulate what it is, but I enjoy stories set in that decade. For whatever
reason. Yeah, me too. Absolutely.
70s, 80s. Rick, do you have a question?
Could you tell us what three characters you're developing? Have we met them in some of your stories already?
Oh, sure. One of the characters, I'll start with the one that most people probably don't know about yet, but I've sold several stories based on this character, and one of the stories has appeared. Rex. Rex is... actually, it's kind of difficult to explain what Rex is because Rex, incarnations of Rex start back in prehistoric days and go 2 million years into the future. But essentially, Rex is a dog, and the novel that I'm going to write about this dog is it's basically, as I pitch it to my agent, it's White Fang 2 million AD, and you have this dog that is basically an unkillable, or at least in his time. He was this unsinkable battleship of a dog. Basically, has a supercomputer for a brain, quantum technology, so you can almost basically he could be burnt to a cinder and then regenerate, you know, reconstitute himself. And one of the baddies, the groups from my other stories, annihilates the planet. And then the planet, you know, a lot of time passes, and the dog was one of the only surviving soldiers, you know, one of the only surviving beings from that time period. And he wakes up. He was buried under a mountain during the last battle, and he wakes up, and his computer brain is damaged, and there are no humans left. And there are just a few tribes of these. Basically, when he comes back, there are a few hominids lurking about, and he sort of adopts some of them. And the novel will be basically him struggling to decide whether to bring humanity back or to let it die. And so that's one character. The interesting thing about Rex, though, is I get to talk about where Rex comes from. And Rex will appear in some of the Jessica May stories. Rex will appear probably, actually have a mainstream series that I'm starting, and Rex may even appear in that. Because Rex's earlier incarnations, he's just a dog. He's not hyper-intelligent, anything like that. Eventually what happens is scientists get a hold of him, and they extract DNA from him and create the super dog. So that's one character. And I think Rick had a question. I saw him gesturing.
Yeah, go ahead, Rick.
Yeah, well, I was just going to ask, what were the inspirations for Old Leech? Where does this incomplete red circle come from?
Oh, the circle itself, I got that from John Langan. There's a really wonderful story that he wrote. I think it was his first professional sale. It was in Magazine of Fantasy and Science Fiction back in like 2002 or 2003. And it was on Skua Island, and there's a scene where the archaeologist is looking at a grave, and there are some runes graven into the stone, and one of them was a worm, like a I can't remember if the worm was a broken circle, but basically, it's not how you described it, but it was basically like a worm curling in on itself. And that's all it was. And we talked about it. I said, what is that? He goes, oh, it's like their god, or I don't know. He goes, it's just a sign of death. I said, can I steal that? Because we don't collaborate specifically, but if you read all of our stuff, we trade, we kind of do the Lovecraft circle thing. We trade things back and forth. And so I took that, and I said, what is that symbol? Is that a worm? No, it's a leech. Leeches are kind of frightening. And I was writing the story called The Broadsword for S.T. Joshi's Black Wings, the first anthology. And so basically the god of these horrifying creatures that are lurking on the periphery of our society, they bow down to this sleeping god, this indolent god, this old leech. So a little bit of John Langan and a little bit of my own ingenuity.
You also have a goat creature whose name I think is Bill.
Yes.
Is that from Shub-Niggurath or is that from somewhere else?
No. Black Bill is just, I came up with that on my own, but I can't take credit for, because if you read Machen or if you read any kind of occult 70s, watch any occult movies from the 70s, the idea of Pan or, it being a kind of like a, the goat being sort of like a symbol of Satan, sort of like the sexual prowess or potency of Satan. And so the idea with Black Bill, although I haven't tipped my hand with Black Bill, I mean, he does exist, or it does exist, but whether or not it corresponds to a Christian sensibility, because I really like playing with the idea that what the Christians call Satan, somebody else might call, another culture might call Old Leech. But I did, as far as the manifestation of that being, that's definitely from Legends of Pan and the medieval legends of Satan. And I just extrapolated what the locals, because I have a pretty complex, at least rudimentary, in a rudimentary sense, I have sort of a complex genealogy and sort of mythology for these various stories. Like that story there that you're talking about, that was in Cashel, in Occultation initially, and then I followed it up with a story in Beautiful Thing called Hand of Glory, which was set in the 20s, about a gangster who goes to that same area, Ransom Hollow. There's another story, Blackwood's Baby, also takes place there. So I have sort of this mythology of Old Bill, and the people in that area, though, they certainly aren't talking about Old Leech or some other cosmic horror type of entity. They definitely associate him with Christian mythology.
Joe, you're being too quiet. I know you have some questions for Larry. We can't hear you. Are you muted? No, you weren't muted. No, you're muted now, but we couldn't hear you before. No, you might have to come back. You might have to leave and come back in. That usually fixes it. Can you hear me? We can't hear you. You probably should exit and come back in, buddy. That'll probably fix it. I'll be back. While we're waiting on Joe, I'll ask you some audience questions later until Joe gets back. Kimberly wants to know, do you have any pre-writing rituals or habits or things that you do to put yourself in the right frame of mind for writing?
I used to. Not anymore. I write to keep the lights on and the rent paid.
Right.
So my ritual is literally getting up after 4 or 5 hours sleep, having a cup of coffee, and hitting it again. Right now I'm not happy about it, but right now I'm writing, I'm working at the computer 12 to 14, sometimes 16 hours a day every single day. So I'm probably going to write an essay or maybe even something bigger about this experience. Because it's changed how I look at writing. But I don't have any rituals. I've actually gotten to the point where I just grit my teeth and start working. The closest thing I have to a ritual is I go back over the previous day's work before I actually start writing, and I'll read, what I wrote yesterday, and then I take off from there.
Right. Joe, can we hear you?
I don't know. Can you hear me?
We can. Yep. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead. Yep. That fixed it.
All right. I'll skip questions for a second. Basically, I'd like Laird to talk. I harp on a couple of things here all the time that are near and dear to my heart, and they're kind of near and dear to Laird's heart, too. So I wanted Laird to speak on women in fiction, as that has been and continues to be a big topic, and reading outside the box. Both of which things, you know, everybody who watches this knows I harp on all the time, right. And Laird is a huge advocate of both as well, so I just wanted him to, you know, speak on those for a bit.
Sure.
Okay, good question, or, you know, good topic. Couple things about that. It leads into you're talking about the three major characters I'm trying to develop, the series characters. The most important at this point is my Jessica Mace series. And I started writing these a couple years ago. And I think we lost Mike, judging by the icon over his face. Oh, there it goes. Anyway, Jessica Mace.
I've got some cats yelling at me. I figured you guys didn't need to hear.
All right, all right. Oh, we like cats. Right, so the Jessica Mace series, she first appeared in a story I wrote for Ross Lockhart's Jack the Ripper anthology a couple years ago. It's a great anthology. Anybody who likes horror, who likes, or is interested in the Jack the Ripper kind of theme, really should check it out. I think it's one of the finest compilations of that kind of writing I've seen in a while. And there's really good stuff in there. But I was lucky enough to have a piece accepted for that. It's called Termination Dust, which for anybody out there has never heard that expression, it's what the sourdoughs used to call the first snow that hit the mountains in Alaska in the winter. They'd look up at their Chugach peak and go, oh, termination dust, you know, because now it's a couple weeks till everything down here is going to be covered. So, you know, it was a horror story, and the idea is that Jessica Mace had her, she was a final girl. And I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with that term, but Sigourney Weaver, Jamie Lee Curtis, some other, you know, Campbell in the Scream series. Basically, the girl who survives the serial killer or the monster that picks right. everybody else off, and then she usually yeah. defeats the creature, at least temporarily. And I really like that idea. We're not, you know, I like taking old ideas and doing something new with them. So I said, all right, Jessica Mace. She gets her throat cut by the killer. He leaves her for dead. He's doing his thing. And she rises up and she kills him. She defeats him. He looks over his shoulder and there she is with her revolver. And in the story, you know, it's an ensemble cast, including the killer. And so she's really not she's probably the main character, but she's not necessarily the star of that story. But when the story was over, I said, you know, what would her life be like after that? And so I have this character. She did her 15, had her 15 minutes of fame. She did all her interviews with, you know, CNN and People and whatnot. Took the money for the exclusive interviews, pocketed it, and disappeared. And she's traveling. And what she's finding, though, she's not really trying to run away from her past as much as she's trying to figure out why this happened to her, and why do other strange things keep happening to her. And she's a very bellicose person. She's not necessarily a great fighter. You know, she's not a martial artist or anything like that, or a gun specialist, but she's tough. She's tough and she's bellicose. And so, as an example, her next adventure, and then these are all sort of loose. I play with the timeline. Like, one will take place a year or two later. Another one might be 10 years from now. Another one might take place during high school. I jump around, but the next story, and this is based on something that really happened here a couple years ago, she's traveling through Eastern Washington, and she finds out that someone is mass murdering dogs. This is something that happened in Idaho a couple years ago. They figured between 90 and 300 dogs over about a six-month period were stolen from people's homes, their cars, their backyards, in their homes, and they would bury them alive. They would just do these horrible things to them. And so she starts investigating. Yeah, and they said, you know, this is really alarming. The feds were involved in it because, they're like, it had crossed from Idaho into Washington, and so the feds are involved. This is felony activity, and they're afraid it's going to escalate to human, murders.
Right.
Well, Mace isn't. That's not her concern. Her concern is somebody's going around slaughtering all these animals, and she's at loose ends, so she hooks up with a coyote hunter, and which is another thing that happens out in eastern Washington. They pay bounties on coyote ears. And so she kind of has this knack. You know, it's sort of a meta thing. You know, how is it that in Murder, She Wrote, how is it that Lansbury is always, right, the murder always takes place, the person drops dead at her feet. So I kind of play with that. I play with the idea that she's always in the wrong place at the right time, but there's going to be an overarching reason for this. And so, yeah, that story, I released it as a free story because at the time my collection was in bankruptcy here, Nightshade was going through that whole bankruptcy thing, and people had ordered my book, and then maybe they were never going to get it. And I felt pretty terrible about the whole thing, so I released a free story for everyone. And I was blown away by I loved writing it, but I was blown away by the response that I've gotten to it, especially from women, because she's tough. And it gets back to what Joe's saying, but she's not a guy with a bosom. This is a woman. Mm-hmm. And the point isn't that she's a woman. That's how I've approached writing gay fiction. I've written quite a few stories from a gay or lesbian perspective. The point is never, and this is the opposite of what you'll see in a lot of horror, the point is never that someone is a so-called minority. It's not, it doesn't, the point isn't that they are a lesbian or they're gay or they're black or they're a woman or some other underrepresented group. They're a person who happens to be from this group. And also, I acknowledge, the thing is, I try to be naturalistic to a certain degree with the Jessica May stuff. She's not indestructible. She's not Faith or Buffy. She bleeds. If she gets hit, she gets hurt. Her thing isn't to go around and karate chop everybody. Her shtick is that she's very resourceful, very cunning, and very relentless. And she has some sort of destiny. And so, the next part of that, one other thing I want to add to that is that my next collection is going to be hopefully finished in another year or so, but it'll be entirely from the female perspective. There won't be any male protagonists. It'll all be from the female or the woman's point of view.
Laird, you mentioned that story that you posted, the free story that you posted. Where can people read that?
It's called LD50. And you can go to my website, Laird Barron at WordPress.com, and it's in the Here Be Monsters, which is where all my free fiction and essays and stuff are.
Okay, great.
And it'll also be collected in the next the collection that my agent has out, which is called Swift to Chase, and she's showing that around right now. But the Jessica May stuff is a really big part of what I'm writing now, and not just because of Jessica Mace, but that universe. I said in an interview recently that my universes seem like they're getting bigger, because I think a lot of people, I told them I'm not going to write as much cosmic horror. I'm going to write some. Mm-hmm. I'm still going to continue with love. I'm in a lot of Lovecraftian anthologies the next year or two, and some of them actually are even Lovecraftian stories, although not all of them. But the universe has gotten much bigger for me because there's a lot of peripheral characters in the Jessica May stories, antagonists in some case, that I've written stories about, and I've got them out to editors and whatnot. You're going to see, the thing is, the trick is, I'm trying to do it in such a way that it doesn't matter what story you read, you will have a satisfying experience. But what I'm, that's job one. But job two, the underlying piece that's important to me, is that when you read all these stories, you'll get another level of satisfaction because they really do tie in and they go a lot of crazy directions.
Well, Speaking of Cosmic Horror, let me ask you a question about that, and then let me try and get to some of these viewer questions. And I just simply wanted to ask you, you've been writing about Cosmic Horror for a while now. Personally, for you, what is it that fascinates? We would all answer this, all of us in different ways, but for you, what fascinates you about Cosmic Horror?
It's sort of a paradox. The closest that I can come to it is one of the other times that I've been sort of in awe when I was racing sled dogs or training sled dogs. The you know, that phobia of agoraphobia, wide place, you know, big places, open expanses. The sensation when you're cresting a hill out, you know, in the Yukon interior, where you have all these small mountains that have been rounded down with age, and it's a gray day, and so the sky is kind of closing in on you, but you can, as far as you can see in every direction, it's just these hills and then mist. You have this sensation of simultaneously you're out in this huge area, but you also feel almost like claustrophobia, like you're being like you're just so insignificant. You know, and this is years ago when I first experienced this. You know, I wasn't particularly introspective when I was 20, and I'd read some Lovecraft, but not in the same way that I read Lovecraft when I went back to him. I think this actually, those experiences with the team and out in the ocean and stuff, because you get something similar on the ocean or the sea, gave me a new appreciation for what he was trying to, when Lovecraft was talking about our minute and insignificant nature in the scheme of the universe. He really put it in perspective. But it's one thing to intellectually understand that. It's another thing to be on the deck of a ship out in the middle of the Bering Sea and experience that, to really awaken to it. And I definitely awakened to it when I was running the dogs on a couple occasions, coming across some of those ranges, those old beaten-down ranges out there in the interior of Alaska. And so it's difficult to articulate in a way that, because it's such an emotional response that I have. It's very difficult for me, despite the fact this is what I do, and I do it all the time, I've done it for years, it's very difficult to articulate. But for me, the sort of prevalent draw, the sort of relentless fascination I have with the cosmic, not even the horror aspect, but just the cosmic, because I think the horror is almost redundant at that point, is this paradox, how it makes you feel, how you can acknowledge this great, vast space, this infinite space, almost inconceivable, and yet you feel as if you're trapped, you know, in a tunnel. Because I've done that as well. I think we all have. You've been, you know, smothered under something, and you feel that suffocation come over you. And so it's sort of this this paradoxical feeling that I get from it. But I also, for many years, have really, I really latched on to the idea that whatever you see out there, whatever the Hubble is drawing in, you know, these stars that are long dead, millions of light years away, can be found in the smallest cell. You know, the ancient Chinese talked about, you know, we're just made up of stars, and that has been proven. And so I like the idea that it's the same, whether you look out into the infinite cosmos or whether you drill down and you're looking at, on a quantum level, it's almost the idea of traveling, you know, around our globe and coming back to, you know, meeting yourself, kind of a thing. That no matter which direction you go, inner or outer, it's infinite almost, at least by our perceptions.
Well, let me get to a few of these questions if I can. Rebecca Stefoff, and I think you touched on this a little bit earlier, but her question is, am I right in thinking that you now live in the Hudson River Valley? Does any of your new or upcoming work use that setting in the way that you've used Alaska and the Olympic Peninsula?
Yes, I live between New Paltz and Kingston. And actually, this new place that I'm moving to, it's over in Stone Ridge. It's only a few minutes from here. So kind of in the southern part of the Hudson Valley, I guess. And the only story that I have written so far, completed, that said here is I wrote a crime novel, and my agent's showing that around. It's it probably surprised a lot of my fans. There is no horror in it. It's a by the book Place Fair. It's a crime novel, and it's set here in the Hudson Valley. And the it touches on a couple other places, but the horror novel that I'm writing is going to take place in this area as well. I haven't written any short fiction, but that's coming.
Okay.
Right now, I'm focusing on Alaska.
You writing straight crime is not surprising in the least. That was almost a given. You know, I mean, that's like something that's been in the background forever, it seems.
Well, you know, right. I think some people, I should probably retract that. I think some of my fans won't be surprised, but or my colleagues especially who analyze this stuff. I will say this, though. My agent, I've got this wonderful agent, Janet Reed, at Fine Print Literary Management, and she specializes in crime. And really wonderful agent, has really helped me a lot. And I say that it's just a crime novel, but she had her doubts in a couple scenes. So she's like, are you sure this is just a crime novel? So,
you know, speaking of, I sent this book to Joe a while back, too. There's a book by the Matthew Scudder detective series, but one in particular, it's set in the 70s, and B, it's this really noir crime novel called When the Sacred Gin Mill Closes. Yep, let me put you on the screen there, Joe. Hold that up again real quick. By Lawrence Block. I think you'd really enjoy that, Laird.
You know what? When I was younger, I've read one of the Scudder novels, but I read Block. I'm sure it was a short fiction. I think it was Joe was talking about reading outside the box.
Right? Yeah, it's one of the things I wanted you to address.
Sure.
I do hear all the time.
Okay, right. Let me touch on that real quick. This is a great segue. I read very little horror over the course of my life. I have read very little horror compared to everything else that I've indulged in. Last few years, I've read a ton of horror because I researched, but also serving as a juror for the Shirley Jackson Awards. And so, of course, you know, their remit, the Shirley remit, is fairly expansive. It doesn't have to be horror. It can be, you know, suspense, dark, as long as it's dark. But, you know, and I've read plenty over the years. But if you take all the horror that I've read and match it against the crime and the espionage and the Clancy stuff and the historicals, you know, I'm a big fan. I was a big fan of Michener and Louis L'Amour and the science fiction guys like Zelazny and Asimov. And these days I read just as much nonfiction as I do anything else. But I really feel like I'm a much better author, a much better stylist for having read very widely, and not just, you know, I think reading broadly has been to my advantage as opposed to becoming a horror expert, because I'm nothing, you know, compared to some of these guys who are walking encyclopedias of Lovecraft or whatnot. I've read a lot of Lovecraft. I like Lovecraft. I've read a lot of Mock, and I've read Blackwood. I love T.D. Klein. I mean, the Dark Gods is the Bible. Peter Straub, you know, and I'm confining myself to, you know, sort of the mentor figures as opposed to the contemporaries. I could go on for 2 hours about the guys and gals you should be reading. But nonetheless, for every Peter Straub, for every T.D. Klein, you know, there's a whole a trunk full of Max Brand and Zane Grey and Frank Yerby and Harold Robbins and Barbara Cartland, for God's sake, that I read growing up. And I tell you what, it's all grist for the mill. And I really think that it's been to my advantage to, you know, I mean, we kind of had a prison in the sense of isolation. We had a prison existence for several years of my youth where we were living, and just we were so isolated. And I was so starved for entertainment that when I got done reading all of the stuff that I was allowed to read or could understand, I voraciously wrote. But, you know, people always ask for advice, and it's such a cliche to say read, read, read. But even, this is not beginner advice, I would say higher level advice to people who are succeeding, if you're really good at whatever it is, you know, that you know, whatever your specialty is, I bet you that you probably are, you're going to find somebody who reads outside their genre. I would lay money on that, actually.
Mm, yeah, smart money.
Viewer Mark Tellen wants to know, Laird, the Croning is superb. Any chance of a limited edition version at some point?
Well, I don't want to speak out of turn, so I won't give specifics, but there will be a limited edition of my first three collections. Somebody, I can't say who or when it's going to happen, but it should be next year or two, we're going to do a big omnibus of the first three books the first three collections I released. I wanted to do the Croning as well, maybe do something like Centipede did for Michael Sisko, where you had kind of a slipcase for like five or six of his books. And I was kind of hoping we would do that, but again, with this publisher. But I don't have the rights to limited edition right now. So long story short is it'll be a while, but at some point, you know, that's going to happen.
Neil Clinch wants to know, are there any plans to make more audio books of your books? Sorry, no, if I read that wrong. I really enjoyed The Occultation and The Croning.
Oh, was that, you said it was Neil Clark?
Neil Clinch.
Clint, okay. Good question. Actually, we still have to sign the paperwork. My other two collections are supposed to be turned into audio books very shortly, like in the next few months.
Awesome.
So, I don't want to be out of turn on that because we still have to. It's basically a done deal, but until the paperwork signed, countersigned, I don't want to say it is, but it looks like it's coming. Yep. So everything that I have so far, so I have five books. Everything but The Light is the Darkness will be an audiobook, I would think, by the fall.
That'll be great. All right, I was going to skip over this question because I think maybe you've answered it. I'm not sure, but people keep asking. They want to know what your creepiest real-life experience is. Is it what we talked about earlier, or is it something different?
Oh, no, that's nothing. And probably the... What does Stephen King say? I won't tell you the worst thing that I've ever done. I'll tell you the worst thing that ever happened to me. Let me think about this for a second.
Sure.
You know what? I'm not going to give you the creepiest thing. It's probably too intimate and too aggressive, but I will say in general, the creepiest is something I'm using in a story. Actually, I'm writing a story about it right now, at least influenced by it, is I have a doppelganger. And I think a lot of us do, but I kind of poo-pooed it for many years. Oh, you know, everybody has somebody that looks, you know, like them, or people make mistakes. They mistakenly think that was you that they saw, and, you know, if you saw a picture of this person that they saw, you go, no, it's nothing. But over the years, it has happened so consistently and in such weird circumstances that I have to put that on the top of my list for kind of an odd occurrence is the doppelganger. If you go to my website, I think you can search for doppelganger and it should come up. I wrote an actual essay about it a year or two ago.
That's right, you did, and I think I posted, this has been like a couple of years ago, about an experience, the doppelganger story that's really creepy. Doppelganger is creepy, man.
It's very creepy, and actually the story I'm writing right now, it's about the doppelganger. I guess if I were to pitch it, it would be it's a woman dealing with doppelgangers of dead comedians. So, yeah, it's well, you'll see it soon, Mike.
anyway,
yes, it's aimed in your direction. It's probably taking place in the autumn, September, October, somewhere in there. But it's not so much that I'm afraid or anything like that, but it's weird and it is off-putting. And
yeah,
I don't want to bore everybody, but basically, people would see me, and this happened in Seattle. It happened in Alaska. It happened in Olympia. It hasn't happened around here. It hasn't happened for a couple of years. Although I had a reader who was a dealer at some casino in Wyoming or Dakota swear that I have been in there. So I've gotten a lot, you know, and a lot of it I can kind of just blow off, but there were a couple of occasions where these people described things that just, one of them was a police officer, you know, off duty saw me, you know, a different part of town, and I luckily I had an alibi. But you know, he went to yell at me if I needed a ride. He was off duty. He was driving his car, and he saw me standing by an alleyway. And the one constant with all these is sort of this off-putting, this doppelganger grins. And a lot of my villains grin in the stories. They kind of have this delight that they take in terrorizing people, and that comes honestly because I had a police officer tell me. I've had several people tell me, but it really hit me when this great big martial art, black belt martial art, you know, kind of a dreadnought of a police officer goes, yeah, it was a creepy smile, man. Because you looked right at me, and you just waved, and then you turned, and you ran up an alleyway and disappeared. And, of course, he didn't go after me. And then, so when he saw, I was taking martial arts at the time, and he came into the dojo, and we were chatting. It took me a long time to convince him that I was not, you know, pulling his leg. It was not me. And
you're absolutely sure you're absolutely sure it's not John Langan paying these guys to do this.
I said I would answer anything, but I can't.
Laird said he had an alibi, but Langan, you know, that's not a very good alibi. We're not really gonna believe him.
Yeah, no comment. I'm not allowed to talk about Langan.
Okay. Oh. That's right. You said nothing is off limits, but Langan's off limits. I know.
Yeah, sorry. I should have specified that. Looking over my shoulder.
Okay. Viewer Nate Wallace wants to know: could Laird perhaps voice any criticisms he has of Lovecraft's work? Are there any stories he particularly dislikes? Excuse me.
Well, I mean, there's the elephant in the room, and I'm not going to belabor it because I'm not sensitive to it, you know, worried about it, but I'm also, I think it's a dead horse at this point. But, you know, the whole Lovecraft's racism, his xenophobia, I'm cognizant of all that. I fall into the camp, let me preface this, I think discussion, there's no problem with the discussion about it, as long as it's a productive discussion, and if it gets heated, that's fine too. I do think there's a lot of posturing on both sides. I've seen posturing on the down with Lovecraft camp. I think some people actually even gone so far as to, on the mild end, be hypocritical. Oh, I hate Lovecraft. By the way, look at my new Lovecraft anthology. I've seen a little bit of that going around. And I got to tell you, I've only got one eye, so when I see that, I got to roll it twice as hard. But on the other, you know, but to me, that's kind of benign. You know, quite a few people. I've seen them say, you know, I've read this on Facebook. Oh, Lovecraft's awful. How can anybody? Well, by the way, my new anthology I'm releasing, or I'm in one, and of course the defense is, I'm sure I saw a little bit of it last week, is, well, but when I'm doing it, it's different. You know, I don't know, it's a little more refined when I'm doing it. Yeah, well, bullshit. The other end, but you know, I can kind of, I sort of overlook it because I think it's benign. People are aggrandizing themselves to a certain degree. I'll toss an incendiary device out there. I think older, you know, me thinks the lady doth protest too much. I think some people have taken a legitimate complaint and used that as their method of getting a little more attention for their own work that isn't probably being received as well as they would like. You know, there's more than one way to skin a cat. If you can't be noticed for your own work, you know, throw rocks at a, you know, a famous person and see if you can get some kind of good response. But that said, I'm not saying that it's not legitimate, but I am cynical about, if you're going to whine about Lovecraft, then don't be putting out a Lovecraft anthology with the defense that, well, what I'm doing, it, you know, but that's different. It's irony, or it's, you know, we're taking the good stuff. On the other end, though, the other side of it actually disturbs me, is the flat-out whitewashing of Lovecraft, essentially. The idea that Lovecraft is above, you know, above reproach. Fuck, he's not above reproach. Lovecraft, I would invite him to dinner. My stance as a creator is, I said this on a panel. I was basically talking, they were talking about pastiches and whatnot. I don't consider myself a Lovecraftian explicitly. I certainly don't want to deny the debt that I owe that to him and his cosmic horror tradition, because I really find that disingenuous. I'm not really a horror author. I'm not really a Lovecraftian, but specifically, I'm more interested in, you know, jumping off from where he's been, and I feel like we're not only is it Lovecraft, but it's any author, classical author, for example. We're always in dialogue with people who've come before us, yeah, and this is nothing new. It's just that Lovecraft is such a narrow, comparatively, he's mining a very deep vein. And so it's really easy to go, oh, tentacles, it's all Lovecraft, even though he did much more than that. But you look at something like, you know, we're all writing in the tradition of Poe. I mean, Poe isn't getting all the credit these days, but, you know, when I'm writing a mystery, thank you, Mr. Poe. When I'm writing psychological horror, thank you, Mr. Poe. When I'm writing a revenge story, it's either Shakespeare or Poe half the time, depending on how macabre it is. And so the bottom line is we're always in dialogue. Lovecraft is just another author that I'm in dialogue with, and I am absolutely shameless and about taking things that I like about him or anybody else and trying to do something new with it. That's the only rule that you have to really, as an artist, you have to really be aware of, is that we don't want Lovecraft 2.0. I don't want to be writing rehashes of Machen or Poe or anybody else. I want to take the stuff that made me thrilled as a reader and inspired me as an author and go farther with it. And Lovecraft specifically, he was looking at something. You know, his xenophobia is a filter, or at least his alleged xenophobia and his alleged racism or his real racism are filters. But he really was, you know, there are a lot of racist and a lot of xenophobic people who are not artistically gifted. He had a real talent, and he was really looking at something. And so when I write in the Lovecraftian tradition or the cosmic horror tradition, I'm not really looking at where he was. I'm trying to look at where would he be today if he were still alive writing? How would he have changed? What would interest him now? And that's what I do. And so it's sort of a circuitous way of saying, yeah, there's all this conflict about him, which I think is healthy. I think we need to talk about this stuff. But I don't think, I kind of get this sense that not only is it sort of, some people are getting a little uncomfortable with the idea that you would draw from Lovecraft's well because it's tainted. But even if you enjoy Lovecraft, you may have to, as an author, you may have to apologize. And to all that I say, it's ridiculous. I can hold two thoughts in my mind. I can have a negative opinion about Lovecraft, yet have an extremely positive opinion about the ideas that specifically his artistic ideas, his cosmic horror ideas. And that's sort of how I approach it. As far as, I'm not going to get into any particular story that I don't like, but I mean, I think it's been beaten to death, but he definitely, you know, had shortcomings as a human being, and, but that is not going to stop me from exploiting that tradition.
Right. I'm real curious about this. When and where did it come into your mind that, you know, I want to be a writer, I want to write fiction, I want to do this for a living? When did that happen?
5 years old. I was a very, very small kid, and I didn't even know how to write. And so I would draw pictures and then make up stories and just, you know, runes, essentially, scribbles, and then tell people what the story was supposed to be. And then when I was in second grade, I wrote my first comprehensible story, and God bless her, my second grade teacher, she took that, we were supposed to do, you know, a few sentences, and I wrote like a 1,200 word story in second grade with crayon, and she took it home, and she came back on Monday morning, and she had typed it up. And she said, you're going to be a famous writer. You know, she did what teachers are supposed to do. She says, you're going to do it, you're going to be, you know, just keep going, you'll be a famous writer if you keep working. She goes, you know, you have a lot of work to do, blah, 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 but... And you know the thing is I remember that I remember that. That's 39 years ago, and 38 years ago, and I remember that with clarity. And by the time I was 14, I had written three novels. We were talking about this. I don't really buy into the idea that there's some sort of word count that you achieve mastery, because there are a lot of examples of people who have exceeded that who are pretty awful, but whether they're selling books or not. But there is something to, you know, to good practice. And I sat down and estimated this a couple times, in excess of 1 million words on paper for me in my teens. And I never submitted this stuff. I lost all of it. My parents didn't. They were not happy. They were really, they thought it was wonderful for the first few years, but after a while it stopped being cute and it became a serious affliction. And so I lost all that stuff. And, they discouraged me. My dad did a lot to discourage me from being a writer. And so in some ways that encouraged me, you know, sort of bullheadedly, I proceeded, you know, made him mad, fine, that's something that I'll pursue. I had to fight. I mean, I literally had to fight to write when I was younger. And, of course, I was impoverished. I ran sled dogs and, didn't have any real money. So any corporate sponsorship I received when I was in my late teens, early 20s, went to the dogs. And I routinely didn't have food and whatnot. And I would run dogs all day. And I had a friend who had an office in his feed store. And two or three nights a week, midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning, I would jump in the truck and drive into town. And I would let myself in. And I would sit this old, I think it was a Corona. It was either Smith & Wesson or Corona. I can't remember. But it was old typewriter with you had to use white out and the whole thing. But because right. The button to erase didn't work. And I was typing stories and into my early 20s. And then I quit for a few years. And then I got back in it right around 28, 29 years old and started selling stories. But, it's something that I would say it goes much deeper than wanting to do it. It's something that I was compelled to do pretty much my entire life.
That's a great story. The typewriter and the teacher. Where would we be? There's a lot of behind a lot of successful people, I think, is a teacher in their past that really encouraged them. So, yeah, that's a great story.
I've got a question.
Yeah, right.
Okay. You have this book called The Black Guide in a few of your stories. What was the inspiration for that?
The Black Guide, the inspiration is not what people think. Although I don't mind it being yet another mythos-style book. I mean, you've got, the Necronomicon, a few of these other ones. That was probably in the back of my mind. But the actual shape of it and kind of what it supposedly contains, there's two things. One, I based it on, you get these little, almanacs, number one. We had almanacs when I was growing up. But trail guides, you know, so if you're going and hiking in a state park or something like that, or just in even any kind of little area, the local charity groups will put out these, the government will put out these little, these trail guides. And so I was like, huh. And I was talking with Paul Tremblay and John Langan a few years ago at ReaderCon. This must be back in 2008. And we were talking about somebody that finds, like, you know, this book. And the book is full of not the stuff you'll find in your typical forbidden tome with spells and whatnot. No, no, no. The book is more like, if you go to milepost 99... Farmer Smith, who's owned that land since 1880, you know, if you go at the right time and you bring him a certain style of pie or liquor or whatever, he might show you what's in the barn. Just be prepared. And that kind of thing. Or if you might find some henges up in the mountains if you go to this one marker, but look for the skull that's been tacked to a tree. And so we were chatting about that. We were talking about all the different editions, because there's bicycle editions in Europe and whatnot. And we're like, what if this Black Guide is just sort of like this pervasive thing, and it's in different formats? Like John Langan's done a couple stories where the Black Guide is a website. You go to the website and it crashes your computer. Your computer just completely just goes foobar, But then all of a sudden you'll wake up at 3 in the morning, the speakers are going, and there's all kinds of weird stuff going on the screen, and it's, you know, it's finally loaded, and it's telling you stuff about where to go and what to do. And so we each vowed to write a story about them, not connected, but just the black guy would be sort of like the commonality. And so we've all done it at this point. It's just that I ran with it and you know, and did a lot of stuff revolving around that. It became kind of an essential part of my mythos. But Paul, you know, the Barn of the Wild, and John Lang have done a couple of really cool stories with it as a centerpiece.
You know, occasionally you use a real book of black magic, like in Bulldozer, you used the Plancy's Inferno Dictionary, I think was the
yes.
word.
Yeah.
I was curious because I'm doing some research on what the original Weird Tale writers used to find these real books in. You know, some people use, Lovecraft used the Encyclopedia Britannica. Derlich seems to have used Montague Summers' books on witchcraft. What's your source for real books of black magic?
Well, I don't. You know, it's funny, is I've gotten away from that since Imago Sequence. That was back in 2007, 2008. I had a collection. Of course, I didn't have any first editions. Nothing exciting, but I had like the Golden Bough. I had a bunch of books about witchcraft in the Middle Ages, and those were the things that I used at the time. But these days I make up my own, and if you'll notice, I don't even really dig into that so much anymore. Like the Croning kind of delves into that, but I also, the first part of the Croning I wrote actually about 7 years ago, the first 15,000 words. And so that was when I was going through I was sort of finding my way. I was trying to use real world naturalistic kind of sources, and De Plancy was one of them. But since then, I've either gotten away from it completely, or I make up my own.
Justin Steele wants to know what your favorite villain is that you've written.
Well, the Children of Old Leech, I think, but the one that I'm really think is going to mess with people's minds. The thing is, you know, I read for several different types. I write for several different types of readers. I write for the casual people that just want to read a good story and they may never pick up another, you know, another one. Then I write also for people who, you know, they like a certain type of fiction. My historical fiction appeals to some people. My Nameless Couple stuff appeals to other people. You know, my more Twilight Zone stuff. But my favorite villain is somebody that will appeal to those who read everything and then sit around and go, huh, what was he, you know, how does that connect with something else? And there's a character called Mandibole who appeared in More Dark as a puppet, except maybe not really a puppet. Mandibole is probably my favorite villain, not so much for that story, but what's to come. Mandibole figures into a lot of stories down the road.
Joe, do you have anything else? Or you're muted still?
Sorry. Yeah. One of the things that often is discussed lately is not women as characters in weird fiction, but women writing weird fiction.
Right.
And like I said, we all know from me blabbering here every week that I'm a huge advocate of that. And I wanted Laird to talk about women writing weird fiction, what they're doing, how vast that talent pool is currently, and historically as well.
Sure. Well, first of all, I'm a huge, you know, historically, I'm a huge fan of Shirley Jackson, for example, you know, recent history at least. But I've dabbled in editing now. I edited a couple magazines. I was a managing editor at a online poetry magazine for a few years. And most recently, I was the guest editor for Mike Kelly's The Year's Best Weird Fiction, the inaugural volume. And, of course, you know, the conceit behind that is that its lasting attraction and value will be this alloy of that's created by each new guest editor adding their viewpoint. It's not going to be Laird Barron and his horror extravaganza 5 or 6 years in a row. It's going to be Kathy Koja and Simon Francis and maybe Joel Pulver. I mean, whoever. It's going to be all these different views. But here's the thing. Weird fiction is a much broader umbrella in some ways, I think, than possibly traditional horror. Nonetheless, though, I have to admit, I do take a little exception to the idea that it's hard to find women who will write this stuff. You know, I look at Stephen Jones, whom I think is a great editor, especially of a certain type, as a curator of a certain type of Western horror canon type of material. But not enough women. There are not enough women in his anthologies, and I don't buy the idea. Joshi, much as I admire S.T. Joshi and have immense respect for him, they're both tripping over themselves by not having more women in their anthologies. I can tell you from personal experience, it's indefensible that you can't find more women. You know, and the thing is, I totally sympathize the idea that you have an anthology or an issue of a magazine. You try to take the best stories, and you don't want to... I mean, this is the defense I hear all the time. Well, I don't want to look at the author's sexuality or their gender or their sexual preference or their race, their ethnicity, whatever. I just want the best stories. But I can tell you, at least from my limited experience, that's sort of a bullshit defense. You may have a problem with an individual anthology. I look at Ellen, for example, Ellen Datlow. Occasionally Ellen has fewer females in it, you know, they might be underrepresented, but if you look over the course of her career, she really finds a great balance. And so I'm not judging Joshi or Jones or anybody else off of one or two anthologies, but if you look at year after year after year, women are being neglected. Female, you know, women writers are being neglected, and I don't understand it, to be honest. I think maybe in purely horror magazines or horror anthologies, it could be that they're not getting as many submissions. My counter to that, though, is your idea of what a horror story is so narrow in that case. You know, I had no problem finding balance in the weird anthology that I edited, which I shamelessly slanted toward horror. I had no problem slanting it toward horror because I'm like, you know what? Whomever comes next year is going to do their thing, and that's Mike Kelly's job as a curator. He's going to say, okay, Laird Barron really, you know, he went with the horror aspect of the weird. Because the horror is a broad umbrella as well. I need to go somewhere else with it this year, and that's what he did. And next year, you know, it's going to be very. I imagine Aikman and the quiet and the more strange tale, as they call it, is going to be well represented.
Oh but, yes, Francis is going to reek of the Numius. I mean,
but so getting away from bashing on those two poor guys, Joshi and Jones, I'm just going to tell you, there's an immense level of talent in the weird fiction and horror field, dark fantasy field. I kind of just sort of all, you know, for my purposes, as a reader especially, there's sort of all, you mix it all in there. And you've got, just for example, a debut author, Damien Angelica Walters, Sing Me Your Scars is coming out. Karen Warren's had collections out. Kelly Link, for anybody who doesn't know who Kelly Link is, go read her immediately. You know, she's the best-selling author type. Livia Llewellyn. You know, just absolutely spectacular stuff. Gemma Files, one of my very favorite writers of any genre. You know, I don't like to, you know, the thing is I don't like to get into the politics of it much, but I have to say I have been hearing this, oh, I can't find, you know, we can't find women to submit. And like I said, on an, you know, there have been, I'm sure there are plenty of cases where people don't get the authors that they wanted to get. It's a deadline. But I am a little bit appalled, perplexed, mystified by the lack of representation. Because to me, the most pernicious idea is that it's a politically correct move to include enough women to fill an anthology and be representative. Some of the finest weird fiction authors and horror authors are women. And I'll go a step further or a different direction. Tons of my fans, and my stuff is not quiet horror in general. I write a lot of visceral, masculine. A lot of my stuff is very masculine if you had to identify it or brand it. I have so many fans among women that it's really gratifying to me. There's an appetite for that stuff, both sexes, all, you know, genders, ethnicities. I have fans all over the world. I don't buy into the idea that, you know, Joshi can't find or Jones can't find more than one or two women when they do a 25 author anthology. That it kind of blows my mind, to be honest.
Yeah, well said. Yeah, I don't want to keep you too long, but I do have kind of a technical question as an editor and writer, Laird. I noticed some of your stories, your characters, they're in quotes, and then some of them, it starts with a dash. Do you have a particular reason for that, or is it just kind of a mood thing, or you know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely. Basically, the non-U.S. Signifier for punctuation. There's two reasons I do it. One, although I'm kind of rethinking this first reason, initially I was doing it because I had, especially in occultation, there's a couple stories in there. There's two or three stories in there that utilize dashes instead of quotation
right.
marks.
Right.
Part of that was for why I did it with all three, or two or three, I think there must be three stories in it that I do that with. The reason that I do it in that case is sort of consistency within that volume. But the more important reason is because I'm trying to invoke a certain type of intimacy with the story. Because if you'll notice, the one complaint that people do complain about it is, I had to read it really carefully. I had to stop and go back and look at it. A little secret. Ellen Datlow, the first few times she read some of my stuff, she really didn't like it. I mean, Ellen's one of my biggest champions. If not for Ellen, you know, who knows where I would be, her and Gordon Van Gelder. But Ellen is really a huge champion of my work. And not only does she buy a lot of my stuff and reprint it, but she also, you know, has really graciously promoted me to film people, you know, newspapers, what have you. I mean, she really, really enjoys my stuff, but that's not what it was initially. She really, the first few times she read my early work, it really annoyed her because it was not, I actually don't want to put words in her mouth. I was just assuming because it wasn't like a lot of the stuff that she had read, and she had to go back and check it out. And when she did, she went, wow, you know, okay, this is actually, I see what you're doing. Because, you know, the thing is Ellen reads, a lot of times she reads to dismiss. I mean, she reads so much stuff. She's looking for reasons to blow you out of the water as opposed to publish you, I would assume. So that's certainly how, as an editor, that's how I read. I'm looking for a reason to smite you. I'm not reading to accept you. I'm reading to, like, how quickly can I get this out of my pile? So, which is sort of a way to reinforce the idea that you're going to get the best stuff, because if it overcomes that, it damn well is good. But the thing is, I don't try to have an adversarial, I think it's really immature to have an adversarial relationship with your readers. I had one when I first started. I thought I was cute the first few years that I wrote, especially when I was a kid. Ha ha ha, this will piss people off. That's a childish way to be. And on the other hand, though, I have absolutely no problem punishing you, the hypothetical reader, for not reading carefully. If you don't read carefully, like if you just try to breeze through one of my stories and jump ahead, you're screwed most of the time. You're going to miss, because I will embed the meaning of the story somewhere in the middle. I will embed some kind of code in there that will help you figure out what's going on. And if you just blithely waltz through it, thinking that you can sort of skim it, yeah, you're fucked. And, yeah, I'm going to get a bad Amazon review for it or whatnot. I don't, it affects me not at all. But, you know, so that's, I guess, just one of the things that I try to do with the non, you know, with the dash punctuation is to reinforce the idea. You damn well had better read this carefully. And it, I noticed that it, because I read the Europeans do it, and it really does create a different, at least in my mind, a different relationship with the story. You read the story in a way that makes you very uncomfortable. And God knows in a lot of my stories, I'm not trying to entertain you so much as I'm trying to make you very uncomfortable. And hopefully you will be entertained thereby.
Well, speaking from the reader side of it, reading your stories with the dashes, I agree that intimate is the word for it, and uncomfortable, yeah. So yeah, I agree. It definitely changes the exact same story would be different with the quotes as opposed to the dashes.
Well, just one follow up on that, because those stories are what I call my nameless couple stories. If you go back and look at them, the couples are never named. They will talk about other characters and name other characters, but in those stories, especially like say 30, the couples never identified. It's just he and she. And 666, which follows that, is he and she. And I was going for something there. Those are my nameless couple stories. And so there was sort of a strategy in place. But since then, I have written a couple nameless couple stories, and I experimented with putting the quotation marks around them. And I almost took them out before I submitted them, but I actually left them in because I realized, since I have dual universes going on, it actually is a signifier that this is not in the same universe. You know, I know it's really, really, really esoteric, but there are people out there that do dig this stuff. They're going to figure out that those are not in the same universe. But the practical effect is it's a different, even though it's a nameless couple story, it has a completely different and warmer, much warmer, because intimacy doesn't connote warmth. Intimacy can be horrifying. Just ask anybody who's had unwanted prison sex. The bottom line is that the quotation marks suffuse are familiar in there, and thereby, even when they're about something nasty, it's the devil you know. You're not as appalled by the devil that you know. And so I have seen the difference in the two strategies.
What got you into parallel universes?
I'm sorry, Rick, would you repeat that? You broke up.
Okay, what got into parallel universes?
Oh, why am I doing it, or
how did I... What was the influence? You know, I can think of about three things from my childhood which got me into parallel universes.
Oh. One of the, probably the one I can just think of off the top of my head, I think there's a lot of other stuff going on in the subconscious. An ex-girlfriend of mine said to me, and let me preface that by saying I kind of experienced this up in Alaska. I almost died in a when I raced my first Iditarod in 1991. I almost died in a blizzard, and I actually hallucinated. I was basically frozen. I froze my foot. I froze my face. And when I say froze, they were going to cut off huge parts of my foot. My foot was like a block of ice. I could walk around it with no shoe on, and it sounded like a tap, like Fred Astaire tap dancing, and I was stuck for 36 hours. It was 40-something below, 30 to 40 below, and it was up to 80 mile-an-hour gusts. And so you do the math. It was, you know, well over 100, you know, well below 100, negative 100 Fahrenheit. And so I came pretty close to dying. And we were stuck out there. My team and I were stuck out there for about 36 hours. And at one point, I hallucinated that the storm... And I can't emphasize this enough. This was real. This was not a dream. This was fucking real. The storm cleared, the sun came out, I got my dogs harnessed, I got them all in piles because I piled them up to keep warm, and we trudged into Nome. We were about 40 miles, 50 miles from Nome, and we trudged into Nome, and I remember people, the guy stuck a mic in my face, and he's asking me, oh, we thought you were dead out there, and I said, me too. And then all of a sudden, it was like an out-of-body experience. All of a sudden, I was floating, and I was drawn back into my body. Boom. I went 50, 60 miles, slammed back into my body. I opened my eye, and it's just my sleeping bag I had wrapped around me. I couldn't get in it. I dared not take my clothes off to get into a sleeping bag and never get out. My sleeping bag was unfurled, and I was clenching it in a death grip. And it was, you know, like, what is it, a 6-foot sleeping bag? It's extended to its length, and it's vibrating about a foot off the ground because that's how hard the winds, the steady wind is keeping it that taut, like a flag. And so I pull it back into my sled, and I was like, I'm still here. Fuck. So, but eventually I got out of it. And so that's one of the, you know, that's one of the things. But I, for years, to this day, I have dreams that I die. There, occasionally I have this weird feeling that, no, it's like the Zelazny, the, you know, in one universe you died, in another one you lived. Mm-hmm. The idea of shadows. And I'm sure that's probably what was playing in my head, but I, to this day, you know, rational as I try to be, there's occasions where I have nightmares about it and I die. I die in the dream and I snap awake and go, you never lived. I'm going to wake up and I'm going to still be in that sled bag, and it's still going to be 1991, and I'm still going to be freezing to death. But so that's one aspect of the parallel universe, the idea that in the other one you die. What really hit me, though, is a few years ago, my girlfriend tells me that I died when I was 4 years old. And I said, really? What happened? She goes, I fell down a flight of stairs and I snapped my neck. She goes, I succinctly remember breaking my neck. And she goes, I blacked out. And when I woke up, I was sitting with my parents. We were watching TV and they said, what's the matter? Because I started crying. And she had that happen 3 or 4 times in her life where she would say, you know, I choked on something and I passed out and then I woke up somewhere else. And she was firmly, firmly convinced that we have infinite. Basically, when you die in this reality, you snap awake in an alternate reality. And what was really interesting is a couple years ago, scientists came forward with this theory that we live, that they're basically, they're infinite universes.
Right.
So that basically it's deja vu, is the universe is overlapping. And so I played with that in Parallax. Parallax was in Imago Sequence, and it's about the artist whose wife goes missing, and his life goes to hell. Everybody thinks he murdered her, etc. I was watching Lacey Peterson, the Scott Peterson, the guy that supposedly killed his pregnant wife in California, or was it Oregon, I guess, you know, beheaded her, killed her, this whole thing.
Right.
It seemed when the prosecution came out and said, here's our case, this is why we think this guy needs to have the death penalty, they laid out this airtight case. He comes home, he washes his blood-soaked clothes, we have him here, here, and here, the times all correspond, we found her body, other women have disappeared in his past when he was in the neighborhood, we think maybe this is not his first, etc. It seems damning. Then Mark Garagos, the celebrity lawyer, comes up and goes, let me tell you what really happened. And he spins this beautiful, in a horrible way, this beautiful yarn about why Scott Peterson is innocent. There's no way he could have done this. And you know he did it, and eventually he was convicted of it, and he's sentenced to death. There's no way the guy didn't do it. But that story that lawyer told was so compelling. He says, really? He goes, what about the neighbor who saw Lacey Peterson jogging 20 minutes after she supposedly disappeared? What about the Satanists that were driving around with their van trying to pick people up? What about them? What about the fact that somebody else disappeared over here? You know, somebody else was like making women disappear, and Scott Peterson was out of the state. You know, all these really compelling. And so what I came up with is the Schrodinger's cat kind of idea, that what if they're both true? What if they're both true? What if he did murder her, and what if he also didn't murder her? And how could that be? And so I came up with the idea. That's where the idea of the split universe really came over me. And then ultimately, I started writing stories that are set in one or the other.
Or the guy that holding the gun to his head with you know, 6 chambers with 1 bullet missing, and
right.
You know, he keeps firing. You've heard about this, apparently. He keeps firing the gun, and he's the one that. One that lives, there's always a guy that lives in a universe, and a guy that dies. So, that's fascinating. You know, we got a couple of troublemakers watching. Some guy named Mike Griffin says, some of us want to hear more about unwanted prison sex, so. And Justin Steele says, what if this Laird is the doppelganger, and the doppelganger Laird is the real Laird? So, I want to throw out those comments.
No comment on Mike Griffin. they'll have to go try it out. Well, you know what? The whole is there anything I could possibly say? You know, if I'm the doppelganger, then how could I possibly convince you that one way or the other? So.
We got any more questions for Laird? I don't want to keep him too long. Joe?
No, but I want to say one thing. I'm like really pissed off. It's a damn shame that I'm not going to be here in 50 years when HBO does the 9-part Laird Barron biopic series. You know, that's going to be really good. I wonder if there's a way for me to come back to watch that. I mean, just there's so much. You know, I mean, I think of whether we pick a Hemingway or a Jack London, you know, as writers that, you know, we can sit and watch, you know, film or a series on. And just, you know, knowing Laird and having heard some of this stuff new and some of it before, it's like I think we could get just one hell of a series out of this.
Names,
who would you pick to play you is my question.
You know, I don't know who I would pick now, but for years, so many people, I never saw it myself, but they would say Robin Williams. For years, people would say, you look like Robin Williams, so.
That's an interesting.
I don't know who now. You know, one of these days, I'll probably do something. I actually have talked to ST and Derek Hussey over at Hippocampus about doing essays, a book of essays. That's something I'd really like to do. I hadn't really thought about doing a memoir, but I think eventually I'll have to. And the only thing I'd say about that is, you know, personal experience. Because people, especially college kids, will talk all the time, well, nothing interesting's ever happened to me. Just because I've had a bunch of crazy things happen in my life, part of it is I'm a writer, so I'm fairly articulate. I can draw out the interesting stuff from all the boredom. Let me just tell you, 99.9% of the time, running sled dogs in Alaska is very boring. It's like being on the back of a it's like being on the back of a tractor. But the point I was going to make is that having an interesting background isn't necessary. Seeing being able to draw the interesting out of the world around you is what's essential. For me, it's just the fact that I have a tendency to write the hard-boiled stuff. I like to write the naturalistic Larry Brown meets Lovecraft meets Stephen King. It's handy for me to have had a wasted youth. My wasted youth comes in handy. It's because it doesn't give me ideas. It's just simply when I'm describing ne'er-do-wells and horrible circumstances, I don't have to research it. I was fucking there. But I'd like to do a lot of other stuff, too, and so I'm at the same handicap as anybody else when I'm writing about an astronaut or a cultist or something. You know, or from the female perspective, I have to do my research. This Boy Scout novel, it's going to kill me with all the research. And so on one hand, it's fun to listen to writers or talk or read about writers and their crazy backgrounds. But I would say this, that it's not, it just gives me a head start for certain types of writing. It's not having a wasted youth is not any kind of secret to success. Suffering, you know, the whole suffering artist thing is ridiculous.
All right, well, thanks, Laird. I really appreciate you coming on. I should have said this earlier, talking to the viewers, but I'm going to give away one of these to a live viewer after the show, and two of these W.H. Pugmire books. Willem sent me a lot of the Strange Dark ones. So, any more questions for Laird before we let him go, guys? Or are we done torturing him? I guess we're done.
I don't think we tortured him too bad.
No, I don't think so. All right. Well, Laird, really appreciate you being on the show.
Oh, wait a minute. I got one last question. This is important.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Duh. I'm old and it's really late here. You know, it's 2 o'clock in the morning or whatever. Are you going to Necronomicon in August, Laird?
That's the plan. I don't know if I'll be on the guest list, but I'll the plan is to be there though.
Great.
Drinking lots of scotch. Because my Griffin brings very fine scotch, by the way.
Well, Mike Griffin, Kelly Young's gonna have to bring some, and our little younger brother Steely J better really bring a few bottles of the good stuff.
Yeah. By the way, well, I'm going to talk about villains. Steely J is a good villain. I've been writing.
Yeah.
He's been appearing at the periphery here a little bit, but thank you guys for having me on. It's a pleasure to talk to you, and it was nice meeting Matt and Rick. Right. So I just I appreciate you guys having me.
Yeah. Thanks for being on.
Wonderful. Thanks for being on. Great guest.
If you're for everybody watching live right now, if you want the Croning or copy of The Strange Dark One, just please send me an email, lovecrafteZine@gmail.com.
Let me toss this out there. I have copies of it too. I'm happy to sign it, personalize it. So
that would be awesome. Okay.
We could probably do something there if anybody's interested.
Oh, I appreciate that. Let me jot down my email address here for everybody watching. Just put The Croning in the subject. And if you want The Strange Dark One, do the same. And as always, I'll use random.org to pick the winners and post them in a little bit on the message board. So, all right. Thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks for being here, Laird. I appreciate it.
Yeah.